but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. But mercy.
And so we come. We come just as we are. We come broken to be mended. We come wounded to be healed. We come desperate to be rescued. We come empty to be filled. We come guilty to be pardoned. And so we come. Welcome to our Ash Wednesday service. Ash Wednesday has always been the traditional beginning of the season that we call Lent. Tonight we join with the traditions of many who have followed before us in their search of God. Many who appeared before God and confessed their sins and who opened their hearts to what God wanted to do. So tonight is a night of presenting, as we present our lives before the living God. The prodigal son is a story where a young man has a moment of reckoning, having taken his inheritance early and gone out and lived life as he desired. He only finds himself to be deeply, deeply troubled, deeply in debt, deeply living a life far beneath what he should have lived. And in that moment of reckoning, he declares, as he comes to his senses, "I will arise and I will return to my father. I will confess to him my waywardness." And the story goes on to tell us that when the father sees him upon his return, his father runs out to meet him. And he embraced him, and he kissed him. Tonight is about arising. It is about arising from the life that we live into a life that God has for us. It is about returning to our Heavenly Father. It is about receiving rescue for ourselves and out of the lives that we have lived. And it is about being restored as God kisses us with his mercy, and we become more and more like what God created us to be. Tonight is about us returning. Tonight is about God restoring. And like the prodigal son, we say, "I will arise and I will return." And when we do, tonight we will be admitting to our sin and our failure and our weakness. We will be admitting to our need for grace. We will place ourselves totally dependent upon the grace of God, upon the mercy of God, and upon God's compassion. Tonight we will surrender. We will surrender our hopes and dreams for a better life, just like the prodigal did as he went out and lived that life. We will surrender that dream for the life of being a better child of God. Tonight, we are called to return to our Father and to be renewed and restored, trusting that God's mercy is enough. That is our invitation, and that is our purpose. With that, let us pray. Welcoming God, so many things in life can be avoided. We can run from danger. We can wiggle out of tight spots. We can explain our way out of bad situations. We can separate ourselves from broken relationships. We can get another job. We can move to another community. We can find another church. And we can even start over after we've experienced failure. But one thing is certain. We cannot flee from ourselves. We are powerless in regards to sin. We are helpless to escape it. We are powerless to defeat it. We are blinded to its depth. We are helpless in understanding how weak it leaves us and how blind it renders us, how self-centered it shapes us, and how rebellious it makes us. And so we come tonight. We come to confess. We come without any masks. We come without any pretenses, without any excuses. We come, Lord God, to find your mercy and to find your grace. We come to be healed. Amen. Integrity is telling myself the truth. Honesty is telling the truth to other people. Honesty is more than not lying. Honesty is often very hard. Truth is very painful. Truth takes courage and strength. What do you see when you stare at the image that is in the mirror? You know, honesty is almost impossible. The more I thought about it, the more I realized such a struggle doesn't really exist in too many other areas. You know, people will be honest if they are under some sort of threat. You know, I imagine like different scenes in movies where there's some sort of threat that is made and somebody is held hostage, and unless you come out with the truth, they will not be released. Or perhaps honesty becomes something that is a last resort. You get backed into a corner and you have no choice but to tell the truth. Maybe you're honest only when you're totally desperate. But you know, most of the time, honesty is very seldom experienced. You and I are masters at putting on airs. You and I love to wear masks. We've learned how to guard our feelings. We've learned how to do what it takes to safeguard our vulnerabilities. And Lord knows we are masters at making excuses. You see, I don't really want others to know the full truth about myself. So I put on an ear. I wear a mask. I guard what I say. I guard my feelings and letting them out. I don't let anyone know that I'm vulnerable. And if push comes to shove, I have more excuses than anyone. We learn that at an early age. And sometimes I think we become so good at it, we are not even truthful with ourselves. I do believe, however, that it is only trust that moves us toward honesty. And if I trust someone implicitly, I will be more honest than if I don't. I would hope after 40-some years of marriage to my wife that I am honest with her. But even so, I guard how honest I am with her. You see, trust moves us towards being honest, but even then, that honesty is not complete. We're that way with God. Seldom do we openly offer ourselves before God for what we really are, how we truly act, what we really think, and how deeply we are committed. You and I have learned how to mask our sinfulness before God, as if somehow we can hide that from Him. We hide our failures from God. And even when we come to a point where we're honest, where we're backed into a corner, and we determine that it's more opportune or more beneficial to be honest, most of the time we struggle in being totally honest with God. I think you and I secretly hope that God doesn't really notice what He sees to be true, or if He notices, He doesn't really care because He has so many other things going on in this world. But I think at the core of all of that is a lack of trust. That you and I are people that are convinced that somehow God wants to bring harm to us. That if we are honest with God, if we are open with God, if we tell God exactly what it is that we are experiencing, that God will somehow be disappointed with us. Tonight we want to dispel that, because our goal is to arise and to go to our Father and to confess. Tonight is about being honest and open, knowing that God, the God of Scripture, is a God of mercy. God is merciful when He disciplines us. He is a God of merciful rescue. Time and time and time again, God in His mercy reaches out and rescues us. God is merciful in His transforming power. When God chooses to come alongside of us and change us, it's out of His mercy that He does us. God offers merciful forgiveness. God offers merciful love, care, and provision. The God of Scripture is a God of mercy. And when God imparts strength to us, it is a merciful strength. God offers merciful healing, merciful love, and merciful acceptance. If we understood that, we would be far more willing to trust that when we are completely honest with God, God's mercy will meet us, will heal us, will discipline us, will transform us, and bring us to a new place, because our God is a merciful God. So let us pray to this merciful God. Merciful God in heaven, it is your mercy that draws us to you. It is your mercy that weakens our defenses and emboldens us to trust you. It is your mercy that disarms our fears and moves us toward honesty. It is your mercy that stirs our hearts to open up to you. Your mercy that allows us to admit our darkest failings to you. Your mercy allows us to confess our deepest doubts and our fears to you. And it is your mercy that encourages us to believe that you will receive us, that you will love us, and you will keep us, though we know that we don't deserve it. It is your mercy that allows us to come out from hiding, to take off our masks, and invite you to see us as we really are. It is your mercy that we seek, O Lord. It is your mercy that we desperately need to find. It is your mercy that heals our souls and opens the door to life without measure. And so, Lord God, grant us your mercy that we might be open and honest and truthful as we come to you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's a place where pain is gone.
How do insecurities creep inside? Why does weakness threaten me so much? Why do I insist on covering over what I know to be true about me? Tell me, when will I awaken to what I am? When will I have the courage to admit that I am not invincible? When will I admit that I need help? Our weakness creates within us a disdain. It keeps within us the ability to discover true strength. You know, I'm convinced that you and I equate weakness somehow with moral failure or character failure. We see weakness as a cause for rejection. If someone were to see me cry, they would think, how pathetic, how weak. If they saw me struggle in an area and fail, they would maybe look at me and say, what a loser. It's like the time on the sports field growing up when we would have alignments and we would all line up and the two best players would choose sides. And it always came down who wanted the last two players, which one were they going to take? And I can only imagine the humiliation on the face of those who were chosen last. And then you were weak. We don't want you, but you're here and we have to take you. You see, you and I believe that weakness is grounds for being ignored. It is grounds for being irrelevant. And in our world, weakness is grounds for ridicule. That's how we see it. We think that weakness is somehow a gateway to failure. That weakness exposes somehow within us limitations. And that somehow weakness disqualifies us from being something special in life. We've been conditioned that way. How many times was I told growing up, suck it up, be a man. Men don't cry. That means you're weak. That is something that disqualifies you. We all look at our world and we see people who make mistakes, people who fail, and the whole social universe, the whole social media platform singles them out, makes fun of them, ridicules them. Weakness is something that we never allow to be seen. But in a moment of great clarity, the greatest apostle who ever lived made a self-discovery. And it might be one of the most profound discoveries that we can understand when it comes to God. He seized upon a freedom that he found, and that freedom was found in this statement. When God said to him, "My grace is sufficient for you, my power is made perfect in weakness." The apostle responded to God's statement, saying, "I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For when I am weak, then I am strong." Toiling under the misguided notion that somehow to be a good Christian means that you always are strong no matter what goes on. I struggled so long with that idea that somehow as a pastor, I was to have the answer. Somehow as a pastor, I was to be strong when everybody else could be weak. Somehow as a man of God, as the head of a household, as a husband of a wife, as a father of a children, they were never allowed or never could see my struggles. And it almost broke me. And then I read a book. And the book was called Leading with a Limp. That those who God uses the most are often the weakest, because we just simply come. So tonight we come. We have an invitation to be restored. For God to look at us in our weakened condition and say, "I don't want you to live that way. I want to make you strong." But first of all has to come the realization and the recognition that I am weak. I succumb to temptation. I struggle with the same things over and over again. I find loving, unloving people difficult. I struggle with hardship and bitterness. I struggle when I see all of the things going on in a broken world and I get overwhelmed. And it's to that that God offers the invitation. And when I receive that invitation, I just simply say, "God, rescue me from me. And restore me to what you designed me to be." Tonight is a night about admitting weakness and receiving strength. Weakness can only be alleviated by God's grace. So as we come near to God's heart, I want you to know we never have to pretend. We never have to hide our sin. We never have to cover our shame. We never have to win God's favor. We never have to use or invent excuses. We never have to seek to somehow impress God. You and I could come just as we are. That is where we are tonight. This is the opportunity before us. And with that opportunity, I invite you now to pray. Receiving God. Excuses are the crutches that accompanied us into this world. From our earliest ancestors, we've sought to avoid the painful reality that accompany our words and actions. We've sought a life of excuses in order to cover up our weaknesses, to deny our wickedness, to hide our rebellion, and to exaggerate our goodness. We may fool others, and we may even fool ourselves, but we cannot fool you, O God, and tonight we realize that we don't have to. So we come to be set free from excuses, to admit to our weaknesses, to tell you that we are broken and need your restoring touch. We need to find a way from where we are to where you, in all of your wisdom, designed us to be. And so we come. We come to be set free from everything that holds us back, from wanting you and loving you with all of our being. Amen.
Draw me close to you. Never let me go. Lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. No one else will do. Nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find the way. Bring me back to you, Lord. Bring me back to you, 'cause you're all. Close to you, never let me go. Lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm free. You are my desire. No one else would do. There's nothing else could take your place to feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring me back to you. You're all I want.
with the ashes now in front of us, it has come to that time where each of us talk with God. Perhaps your talk with God tonight will be in the form of words that are silent. Just thoughts that bubble up on the inside that you give voice to on the inside. Perhaps that time of talking with God will just be in moments of reflections and recollections of the past. Perhaps the past that you've sought to escape. You know that experience when you close your eyes and you can recall something from the past that was so horrible. Perhaps that is how you talk with God tonight. Perhaps tonight you do it with spoken words. That you talk with God with honest, heartfelt confessions. As you explain to God the things that you need to be honest with, maybe for the first time in your life. With the ashes in front of us tonight, maybe it's time that you talk with God by writing things down on a piece of paper or in a journal with sincerity, listing out the things that are important to you. I don't care how you talk with God tonight. I just know it is important that you do. Perhaps in writing things or sharing things or reflecting on things, you can reflect, express the wrongs of your past. Perhaps promises that you made to God that you never kept. Perhaps there are desires that you wish to experience in becoming changed or transformed. Perhaps there are things about your personal life that you are not very proud of and ashamed of, and you need to just talk to God about getting those things made right. Perhaps in talking to God, you talk about virtues that you want to have, or so that you are restored into what God called you to be. Listen, hear these words. Tonight is not about saying, "I'm sorry." Tonight is not about promising God that you'll do better. Tonight is not about making some statement that says, "Okay, Lord, I'm going to change." You're too weak. You're too dishonest. You don't have it in you for those things. And God is not interested in hearing those things tonight. God just wants you to freely admit the things that are dearest in your heart. This is the place where your powerlessness encounters God's power and God's changing grace. This is a place where your brokenness is met with God's open embrace and unconditional love. This is a place where your mortality, your life as a human being, dust and ashes, meets up with and encounters true immortality. This is a place where your frailty, your dust, your ashes, experience its life-giving spirit given to us by God. Whatever, don't let this moment pass. Take this time during this piece of music and talk with the living God.
Thank you.
Where are the places that you return to over and over again? I return to the home that I grew up in. Every so often I drive by and I return to those memories that were connected to my childhood. Memories of having fun and memories of doing things with friends and memories of experiences that I had that made my life rich. I can't help but drive by there and return back to those as I return back to the physical home that I came from. I return to relationships that have deeply enriched my soul. Relationships with friends over the years. Relationships with mentors that have poured themselves into my life, many who have gone on to be with the Lord. But I return to memories associated with them and return to relationships that I've cultivated. But I also return to failures and hurts, pains and deep wounding experiences. You can't help, if you're human, but to go back and to feel those pains sometimes as if they've happened all over again. I return to failures with people, to words and actions that I took, things that I'm not proud of. I wince sometimes because as human beings, we are returning creatures. I want you to know that tonight is not about a one-time moment. Tonight offers an invitation to return again and again to the one who longs to receive you and bring restoration to your life. Return again and again to the one who can be trusted to be real with, the one who will receive you openly and honestly and never ridicule you or be disappointed in you. This God whom I'm calling you to return to over and over again, this God turns the other cheek, walks the extra mile, offers you his cloak as well. This God does not regret his kindness or his compassion or his mercy. This God does not grow weary in being gracious. This God never threatens to walk away or abandon us, never wavers in his commitment to us, never considers withdrawing his love. This God never keeps a record of the wrongs that you have done. This is who God is at his core. I invite you, let us return there often. From the moment that we were called by God, God has desired us to lean in to his presence so that you and I might become that reality of the deepest desire that God has for us when he made us in creation. I want you to know tonight that you can be far more than what you have limited yourself through being dishonest and through being afraid. You can be far better than you ever imagined or that you ever considered yourself to be when you're open and your weaknesses are brought out before God so that God can fill them with his strength. I want you to know that you can live a much deeper life of fulfillment and contentment than you ever imagined. Our restlessness, our discontent, our bitterness and anger, and all of those other things that limit our lives are simply a result of hiding from who we are. All of this awaits you as you respond to God's call to come just as you are, to come again and again, and to honestly, openly engage with the one who promises that nothing on heaven or on earth can separate you from his love. Let us pray. Life-giving God, you created us out of the dust of the earth. Help us remember that it is only by your gracious gift that we are made whole. Save us, O God, from a blindness which is not even aware that it is that we are sinning, from a pride which cannot admit that we are wrong, from a self-will that can see nothing but its own way, from a self-righteousness which can see no flaw within ourselves. Deliver us from callousness, which is sin so often that we have ceased to care, from an evasion that always puts the blame on someone or something else. Give us eyes that are open to our faults, a conscience which is sensitive and quick to respond to goodness, a heart that cannot sin in peace but is moved to regret and remorse. And life-giving God, keep us close to the wisdom of the ashes and for the renewing gift it brings. Amen.
Thank you.
Now let me bless you. May the memory of your incomplete humanity awaken you to the wonders, joys, sorrows, and pain of life. Let the ashes that you see be the ashes of transformation, awakening you to the beauty and love of seizing the moment. May it be said of you when your journey on earth is ended that you lived fully, that you loved extravagantly, and you experienced all that God dreamed that you can be. Go forth as those who are fearfully and wonderfully made in the image of the One who is, who was, and evermore shall be. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.